A 21-year-old woman has been charged with the murder of a 21-year-old man in Liverpool. Kyle Farrell was found with a stab wound to his chest at a house in Chercoat Street in the early hours of Friday morning. He died later in hospital.
Like some people are saying, it's a good thing to fall in love with your best friend because you know them. But do you know them?
I just had the knife out and I was saying to him, stop him. And then next thing you know, he said, Fri, you've stabbed me.
In that courtroom, she was told, she's a murderer and you're going to jail.
My daughter's not a murderer. She didn't intend to kill Kyle.
You plunged a knife inside someone. That's murder, so she deserved the outcome.
No one knew the extent of what was going on behind closed doors. Had that evidence been available in the beginning, you know, we may not be sat here right now.
She feared for her life at the end of the day. People will say he's the victim because he's the one who's lost his life. But the real victim in the case was Fri.
I don't believe for one minute that the only way out of that situation that she claimed she was in would mean killing my cousin.
Emergency service.
My friend,
do you want an ambulance?
Hello?
It was weird that night because I couldn't sleep. It's like I knew something wasn't right.
There was a banging on the door. It was about 5 o'clock in the morning. So I'd come down the stairs and opened the door and it was the police. My first word to the policeman in the car was, has he done something to me?
At first, I just thought it was Fraser. So my heart dropped and I was like, what? And then I was told. And then I was relieved. Naturally, it's my sister. It isn't her.
The night our cousin died, my mum phoned me instead at home and she said Kyle had gone. All of his friends was there. The house was absolutely chocking and never seen so many young males crying. The family liaison officer said a female had been arrested. So straight away we did know that was Fraisha.
A mother of two from Liverpool who stabbed her partner to death during a drunken row has been jailed for life. The Liverpool Crown Court judge ordered 22-year-old Fri Martin to serve at least 13 years.
Judges have agreed to allow Fri to bring a full challenge to her conviction after her lawyers told them there is fresh medical evidence relating to her mental state at the time of the killing.
A huge shock to us all that she's actually got this appeal. There's a possibility that she could walk free with manslaughter, and obviously we'll be heartbroken as a family if she does get released.
This is me and Felicia with the kids. This was like a family day that they have in prison. I think there's about 3 a year where they can play with the kids. And for that little while, you forget that she's in prison. They were nice days. This is a letter from jail. I must have read it then, but it's been 6 years since I've seen her. She said, I've been in here for a year. It's dragging, and I don't know if I'm coping properly. I just want to come home, Mum. I've come to terms with the fact that Kyle's gone, but I miss him. And even when I get out, it's not over. I have to explain to my babas what happened, that I've accidentally took Kyle's life. What if I don't get my appeal, Mum? What am I going to do?
Me and Farrell, she's just my best friend, really. Like, I've known her my whole life. As a teenager, she was just fun. One of the lads, to put it in like a scouts term, like she could be, she's one of the boys. The nights out were just boss. After a drink, it'd just be like boom through the roof. She'd hold sort of the group together. She's like the glue.
I knew they were friends, Kyle and Fri, first at school. She told me when she was about 16 and that was a boyfriend. I don't think she knew what love was then, but she said she loved him. So it made me giggle a little bit. She used to get changed like about 2-3 times a day. Always wanting to look nice for him, and she was shining.
When I first heard about her being with Kyle, being the older brother, being a brother, and I think the first thing that comes into your mind is, well, you better treat her right. You know, behave yourself, treat her right.
In Toxteth, it's quite a small community, but everyone knows everyone, and when he passed, everyone, if you just walked the shop and they'd be like, have you heard about Kyle? Like, everyone knew. It can be a bit much if his mum. That's Kyle with Kathleen, his mum.
He just loved his mum so much.
Yeah.
Vice versa, you couldn't say one bad word at all about Kyle, or you get a clamp on the head off Kathleen.
Yeah. Now, Kathleen's living without her only son. Kyle was like a big brother to me, definitely. Like, growing up, we did everything together. And I think he's seen me as the annoying little sister.
He had a cheeky character. But Kyle was really, really shy as a person. Because how shy Kyle was, I didn't think he would even be able to speak to the girl. So when my mum did say that he was with someone, it was like, God, that's a shock.
He just adored her. He really did adore her. He was obsessed with her. He loved the bones of her.
Remember when he passed, I obviously identify his body, and he just looked so peaceful though. He just looked asleep. It was hard to see him lying there, and but he did, he looked at peace. We all know Fry's gonna have to live with it forever, but I think the longer it's gone on, the less pain she's feeling. She's accept that he's gone, he's not in her life. Her only aim is to get out and live her life now. I feel like 6 years is not enough. What then? Your auntie walks a shop and she bumps into the woman that just killed her son.
I think as well, it's all good. You want to get out for your children, but you never thought about your children when you stabbed the father to death. Your kids were upstairs while the dad's lying dead on the floor.
You were arrested this morning?
Yeah.
Okay. The interview has been recorded at Wavertree Police Station. It's maybe given an evidence if your case is brought to trial today. I just want to talk about Kyle and about your relationship with him.
Well, I've known Kyle since I was five. I went to the same primary school. I got with him when he was 16, 17. He would be loving. He'd be the one to cover me first and kiss me first. When it was good. He's a good dad as well.
I don't really know whether it was planned, but he put it on social media, like, over the moon, I'm having a little girl.
It was the happiest time of his life. He was really good parents. I don't think anyone can say that he wasn't. The kids were well looked after.
After she had the first baby, straight away she got pregnant again, because there's only 10 months between the babies. She wanted to move out. She said she needed her own space and everything, and she was going to move in with Kyle and they were going to be a proper family, and I said okay, obviously. He was always ringing her, messaging her constantly. And I just thought, well, he really loves her, you know. He wouldn't leave it alone.
Me and Fraser, we both had babies exactly the same time. And we actually got really close. I could talk to her and she knew she could confide in me. That was, I think, the hardest part, was that she knew she could confide in me, and she had confided in me, but she didn't confide in me about the right things.
She was one of them people, like, you'd ask her, is there a problem? She'd just say no, and then you just don't ask ever again, do you know what I mean? Like, it's just one of them things, that's the character she is, it's just no.
Quite early on, there were some strains, but you never look at it and think it's something serious, because, again, they're a young couple, they've got two very young children. It's hard on anyone, so you don't think that it's something that you should be concerned about. It's just a normal, everyday stresses and strains of having children.
It was just over time that we've seen the shift. She started getting more... She started becoming more reserved. It wasn't the same for Aisha. It was like she was just floating.
She was just in tracksuits all the time, and, you know, or you'd go around to the house and she just wearing dress, she might be in her pyjamas, and you could see the changes in her, personality. She was becoming more and more withdrawn.
At first, I used to think maybe her appearance has changed because she's tired with motherhood, or she can't be bothered. I'm a mum myself and now I can get tiring. But that wasn't the case.
And you mentioned about the good things. What were the bad things?
He'd have big arguments and stuff. He'd scream in my face. He'd never hit me or not, and he'd push me. It'd be more so me. I'd slap him, or I don't know, I'd scratch him or grab him where he's been in my face.
Once we was in Kyle's mum's and I'd seen scratches down his neck, and I literally just made the comment, "Are you getting bullied?" And he just done a smirk to me and said, "See you later." I know he was from here. I will never sit and make him out to be an angel and she was all a bad one. But when it comes to this, I do know that Kyle was the victim in it.
He wasn't violent or nothing. He was just audible with his words sometimes.
What sorts of things would he say to you?
Call me slag. Dog. Say it was fat. tell me to go and see other lads who I used to be seeing before me and Emma got together. Just things like that.
She felt unattractive. She felt like her body was destroyed because these are some of the things that were being said to her.
You can put your makeup on and you still feel ugly because that's what you've been conditioned into. Every day, if you're ugly, you're fat, you're not worthy.
You know, when you think, but all you have to do is look in the mirror. But if you hear something so much, you know, especially when you're really fragile, you know, your hormones are everywhere from having kids and stuff. You know, it's really easy to believe that. If you say the right thing at the right time, you know, it can break somebody's spirit. And that's what she reminds me of. She was a shell of herself.
I miss them so much. I never thought to say, but I went on back for them and asked them for support.
Yeah. He's still here with you, Carl.
Then, baby.
They were on and off quite a bit. Carl was forever coming back to his mum's with his bag. His night bag. And we go, not again. He'd always go back to it. I told him many times to get rid of it. She's no good for you, get rid of it, get rid of it. But he wouldn't, because he loved it. She needs to be punished and served the full time for what she's done. What she's done to my sister, myself and my family. And we won't be very happy.
Yeah.
If she walks.
Rest in peace, Kyle.
Like, you know him better than any of us.
Yeah. Me and Kyle, like, I wouldn't get another friend like him. Like, the connection, a special type of friendship connection, I wouldn't get that with anyone else now, I don't think. If I'm like my soul brother, if that's a word, like, you know. But yeah, it's a shame. You just never think anything like that. It'd come down the line where someone loses their life and someone loses, kids lose their parents. It's not even like one parent, it's two. It's Kyle and Fry's family, isn't it? Their family with their two kids. And then it's ripple affected onto families all around. It's just so sad, isn't it? Well, they did love each other, you know what I mean? I'm not going to stand here and just say lies and like, oh, they hated each other and that, but they loved each other, do you know what I mean? Me and my missus, we argue, we fight, do you know what I mean? I think every couple goes through bad spells, but never in a million years did I think that it could ever come to that, do you know what I mean?
I'm sorry, innit, but you've got to be honest about things and that, innit?
Fraser forgave Kyle every single time anything happened. But then something happened that broke her heart.
One night, Fraser had gone out for a night out. And I had the babies overnight. The next day, around 3 o'clock in the afternoon, she pulled up in a taxi. She just burst into tears. And she barged past me and said, Kyle's got another kid.
That was the worst blow for her.
I found out
he
had another kid to another girl. She lied to me for like a year. I just couldn't trust him ever again. Like I wanted to, but I couldn't. No matter what we argued about, whether it was something stupid, it all boiled down to that. And since I found out I've seen other lads, Then after a while, it was just like, I don't know, we miss each other and still at all, so we can and work together and try and be a good bit of fun.
Okay.
Yeah.
Whether the night it happened, that argument was about the other child, we certainly know it was still playing up Faisha's mind. What breaks my heart is that after he died, there's been DNA tests and the child isn't Kyle's. That's quite hard to think about because it definitely makes me question whether he'd still be alive if that news was out way before this.
This is where we grew up, South Liverpool, Toxteth. It was a good community. Everyone's doors were open. We were all always mingling with each other. There's our school there, our primary school we all went to, St. Silas there on the right. This is our house where we grew up. This was my mum's house in the corner here. There's a lot of laughter, a lot of parties. This was for Aisha's childhood, this house. Because I was the older brother, I was always like giving her cuddles and, you know, we were so, so close when we were younger. It's obviously when I moved out, we wasn't as close then because I moved
well,
right
out. Well,
that's
what happens with families, isn't it?
Yeah, that's it.
None of us were close enough for us to tell her what was going on behind closed doors.
For Aisha, is most probably thinking to herself now, it might have been better to tell her brothers. I would have given him a little slap, and I'm going to be totally honest, because obviously anyone would, doing that to a young girl, doing that to my sister.
At the end of the day, it could be us on the other side visiting their grave, and I'm glad we're not.
With the appeal?
I'm just hoping Freysia does get out. She has got a chance, and I think it's a 50-50 chance. I wouldn't give her any more than that, to be quite honest.
You said that Kyle would never hit you. Is that right?
Yeah. Yeah, no, he was never, like, the only thing he'd do was, like, push me away or, yeah. So he would never, like, punch me or kick me or...
You seem to have this perception that you haven't been assaulted unless you've been punched, don't you?
Yeah, I don't know what you...
But violence has many ways. If someone pushes you across the room, that's an assault.
Yeah.
If someone pushes you in the face, that's an assault. If someone grabs you and marks you, potentially, that's an assault. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
There's been times when Fraser's come into my house with, like, black eyes. One time that sticks out the most, she said, oh, my God, have you seen what the baby's done to my eye? And I was like, oh, God, yeah. You know, she'd had, like, a bruise under her eye with a slight, it was a slight cut, like, scratch as well. And I was like, how did she do that? And she said, oh, she threw a bottle at me, you know. And at that point, I was just like, oh, my God, you know, how do you react to that? We sort of laughed it off and, you know, talking about a kid being abusive. Now I think about it and I think she was so forthcoming with the excuse before I'd even noticed there was anything wrong. How did I not pick up on the classic obvious signs, things I've gone through myself, I still didn't put two and two together.
Kyle loved football, like he was absolutely obsessed with it. So I think it'd be made up that we were still, you know, making the effort to go down and supporting his team. We enjoy it, speaking to people that like he was seeing each week and spending time with.
His football manager, they'd always told us how much he was one of their best players.
You can just tell how much, like, he impacted the team. I think they still feel his absence today.
Is that Kyle's t-shirt number?
No, it's like the new Kyle. But no one could fill them shoes right, so he's having a go.
He was right back, I was right mid. He was always behind me on the footy pitch, you know what I mean? He was my little...
Yeah.
Like, me and him were like criminals on the pitch. Steve rang me saying, like, have you heard about Kyle? And then he was crying, just like, lad, he's dead. He's just... Come on, what? You chatting shit for, lads, or chatting shit like that? It's like, nah, lad, he's gone, lad. He said his bird stabbed him and it's like, what? I was gonna say, no one's perfect in that, but still didn't be fucking safe, that, you know what I mean? No one deserves that.
Yeah. And what I knew of him, like, he's the boss kid, you know, he's a family kid, ain't he? Our kids are that young. But he was committed character, so. In my time as this club, I'll always make sure he's remembered for the right things. You know what I mean?
Nothing's going to bring Kyle back. We understand that. With that appeal coming up, there's only one outcome we want for Fraisha. And that's to stay behind bars.
She did keep it hidden from so many people. But then eventually she confided in me. It was early in the afternoon and she had one of the girls in the pram. I'd seen a mark on her face and I asked her what it was about. I asked her where she got it from. She tried to brush it off. She said she'd knocked her face and I just said, I know you're lying to me. I could also see her getting a little bit emotional when I kept asking her. And then she broke down. She told me Kyle had been hitting her. It happened before. I did say to her a couple of times, just leave him. And she just kept saying, I can't leave him. She told me not to tell anyone. And I was a loyal friend to her and I didn't tell a soul that. Now I think I should have said something.
Through the, well, the interviews, you described Kyle as being this good father, quiet person. That you were the one who were probably the worst out of the two because you've scratched him, hit him. You know, we did touch on the fact that he said he's pushed you and that constitutes an assault. You know, he's been emotionally abused.
Yeah, I don't know, I think. Been embarrassed that he is violent towards me and I can't allow it. Yeah, he was violent towards me. Give me both free rahas all in all. I was pregnant one time and he'd kick me in my belly and I'd say to Kyle, well, what are you doing? You haven't even been brought up like that. Like, why are you hitting me? He got control and was telling me to get in at certain times, trashing, and I knew I got putting holes in my walls, booting my back door in because I wouldn't let him in the front, so he'd come round the back. Stronger than me, he used to pin me down all the time and shouting in my face. And like one time, he'd spat in my face when I was out my friend's house.
Do you think it's possible that Farrell saw a Kyle that you all didn't know?
I'm not too sure to say that she's seen a side that did all these horrible things. I don't believe that because we know what lads our auntie brought up and the childhood he had and the morals he was brought up with, that it doesn't sit well with me.
when he did hit me, I give as good as I got back, I did. But he'd always overpower me.
When I heard about the things he'd done to her, it made me feel disappointed in myself because I thought that I felt disappointed in myself because I didn't carry out the duties of a big brother. That's how I felt at the time.
Let me just tell you where we're at with the appeal. We instructed a psychiatrist and a psychologist, and they've done a number of reports between them.
And what we found was that
she had post-traumatic stress disorder
arisen from the abuse and coercive control and violence that she'd suffered at the hands of Kyle.
Coercive and controlling behaviour is a form of domestic violence, if you like, which is also about somebody who tries to control you, really, control your movements, prevent you from having contact with your family, tell you what you can do and what you can't do, as well as using violence. If the court accepts that she has got post-traumatic stress and that was played a role to reduce her culpability for the murder, if the court accepts that she was a victim of violence and abuse, that would mean they would quash her conviction for murder.
Everyone says she's got a strong case, and with this new evidence and the mental evaluation, I can't see any way how to deny it. And I don't even want to think if they did. So I'm trying to stay strong and positive, and
yeah.
It's got to be her time, hopefully. Fingers crossed.
Yeah.
The day it happened, Farrell had gone Christmas shopping with a friend, Katrina. Kyle was minding the kids at the time.
Katrina met me. We decided we were going to town. The Christmas tree lights were coming on. Got a bit of makeup. And then Kyle was messaging me, rushing me, telling me to hurry up and calling me all sorts. Basically telling me if I don't come home, he's going to smash me by the door.
She ended up going home early and they argued. Later on in the evening, he said it's okay if you go to Katrina's. I'll mind the kids. The PlayStation say, go on, you go to Katrina's. Have a drink up there.
It got to a certain time, he started messaging me. He was like, well, hurry up. Basically, I was just making up excuses just to stay a bit longer. Then when it started getting a bit like early in the morning, it was just fuming basically, like, oh, you do this every time. Because I do it early, and it pissed them off.
Do you want an ambulance?
No!
Hello? Hello? Hello?
We're having a little argument upstairs. We hear banging and stuff. You were like, what was that? That kind of stopped the argument. Basically, someone's come in the house. He'd gone down the shower and, what are you doing? Get out of my house. And, like, they were having a little scruffle. I'm shouting, what's going on? You know what I mean? He shouted, Fry, stay upstairs. And then next minute, he shouted, Fry, Fry. Well, Fry had been stabbed, calling me an ambulance.
The 999 call, yeah. We've had it transcribed. Female at 0401 has picked up baby, baby, look at me, look at me. I didn't mean it.
If she didn't lie and said what she should have said, that she killed him, and she didn't mean it, she would not be sitting where she is now.
Right, I think it's time to be honest with us and tell us the truth. This is your opportunity, Fry. You've been interviewed over a very serious allegation. I'm lying to us. Won't assist you. Do you understand?
Okay.
Sure, you can have a break.
First and foremost, I want to say sorry for lying. But when I'd gone upstairs, it was, have you got a ciggy? I was like, oh no, I didn't have enough money. He's fuming because he had a split and obviously couldn't smoke it without the ciggy. He was kicking off saying, you know, I take the piss, calling me names.
The argument had just got worse and worse. He'd ended up pulling the TV off the wall and things like that. And then they'd ended up in the kitchen and he throttled her.
He's grabbed me by my throat. My eyes were streaming as well, where he had a hold of me. Like, I felt like I couldn't breathe, and then I was limp back, pushing on Tom to get off me. He still had a hold of me, so I was pushing him more. Eventually let go of me. We all pushed him like towards the sink. And I just reached for the knife and I said, keep off me, otherwise I'll stab you.
Neighbours heard her shouting that she was going to stab him. And Kyle saying, go on then.
And then he was saying, go on. I dare you, go on. He was like coming, like towards me. I was saying, don't, you better stop it.
And she's held the knife out straight. And from what she said was, he thrust forward and came onto the knife.
Next minute, you know, he was caught. I didn't go to stab him.
Right, he's got a stab wound that's gone in and up. Not straight in. If you've stabbed him,
yeah.
And it's not, as you're saying, that he's walked onto it.
No,
if you've stabbed him with that knife, okay, but let it tell us now.
No, I haven't. I swear to God, I didn't intend to stab him. I just had the knife out and I was telling him to stop it and it was still coming. I didn't feel it go into him, nothing. I just couldn't believe it when he'd said, oh, now you've stabbed me.
She done it. She picked the knife up. She killed him. No one else did. She intended to kill him and she killed him.
Picked a knife up thinking that was the one I used, well, the one that stabbed her. I went outside. I was panicking. I quickly wiped it, just threw it in the bin.
run back in.
I think I would have done the same. Like, I had to put myself in her shoes. My kids are upstairs. You know, I've got a knife in my hand, he's on, like, collapse. And, you know, she obviously wasn't thinking straight because she hid the wrong knife. Had she planned this and had this been her intention, she'd have hid the right knife.
The last thing I would have done was thought about picking a knife up and leaving anyone on the floor dying and trying to hide it. That was seconds she could have saved his life.
Fri, is this not a case of you've had enough of him really?
No.
Because of what he's doing?
No.
And you have actually stabbed him on purpose?
No. I didn't mean to stab him.
But isn't the fact of your actions later on, doesn't it bear out the fact that you've stabbed him on purpose, i.e. you've run from the house to hide a knife?
Do you know what? I just weren't thinking. I was panicking. I wish I just would have told the truth then. That night. I don't know why I lied.
I thought, there's no way she's going to be getting sent down for murder.
How's that self-defense when you're the one with the weapon?
She wasn't protecting herself. If you were strangling her that much, she would have bruised a bit. There was not one more on her to say he was doing anything like that to her.
We can sit here and say, oh, she should never have picked up the knife. Well, she never did ever pick up a knife until that day. All the times it happened and all the abuse that she endured, she never ever picked up a knife. That day she had enough and she said, now you have to stay away from me. And she feared for her own life, it's simple as that.
The moment they come in and deliver the verdict, like, everyone was tense, everyone was holding hands.
When the jury stood up, I just remember looking at the jury woman and she looked over and she burst out crying.
It was unanimous for murder.
I can't even explain. I just broke down.
Although 13 years will never come close to the heartbreak that it caused. You know, it was a sentence that we as a family felt, okay, this is the justice we're gonna get.
On June 9th, 2015, Fri Martin, at the age of 22, was convicted of the murder of Kyle Farrell, her violent partner, and has been... I don't want to read this. I honestly don't want to read this. I really don't, no. I'm not going to read stuff that, especially Justice for Women, has put in shit up and calling them no way. Like many victims, she struggled to give an account on the full extent of Kyle's abuse. I just know it's lies, and it's sad the fact she stooped so low when he worshipped the ground she walked on. So it's sad that he loves someone so evil. Eventually, during her interview, she was able to describe some of the serious physical and controlling behaviour she experienced, including that Kyle had kicked her in the stomach when she was pregnant with their child. We're going to hear a lot of worse stuff that may get said about Kyle. And they're going to keep going and keep going. Yeah, they're destroying the victim's family while they're at it. What are people going to end up thinking about them? We have got a good barrister. He's going to protect Kyle and his name in any way that he can. He will get to keep the truth the way it is, and hopefully we win it again.
Sorry, I'm nervous, I'm shaking.
It's okay.
I'm getting ready for my daughter's appeal tomorrow in the High Court. She got convicted of murder of a partner. Or should have been manslaughter, so there was many years, you know, of abuse. We didn't know about it.
She was maybe scared or shy to say everything to you.
Like ashamed, yeah. My nerves are getting the better of me, but not long now. As my daughter says, look on fleek, Mum. Look your best. Hi, Baba.
Hi, Mommy.
Okay. Yeah, you.
Yeah, I'm alright. I'm just kind of nervous now.
I know. I'm nervous too, Baba.
No one thought to be found guilty of murder in the first trial.
Listen to me now. This is what Harriet's saying. She said, well, like, about the manslaughter thing. If you get a manslaughter, I said, well, what's the motive? She said, well, she can't see it being a lot of years.
Regardless, you want to drop to a manslaughter, it doesn't matter.
I know, Baba.
Do you know what I mean?
Well, it matters. I know, but it matters how long it is to me, Baba, because I want you home. I know it doesn't matter to you, but it matters. It matters to us.
But you know what I mean. I mean, don't cry, Mum, please. I don't.
Okay. I'm not. The tears haven't dropped. I promise. They haven't. That's the truth.
I think I'm just more scared.
I know.
Having to tell the girls that I'm not coming home if the worst happens. That's obviously what I'm scared of more than anything.
It feels like when she was getting sentenced. Yeah, it's that same kind of feeling. My stomach feels like a washing machine.
There are three possible outcomes to the appeal. She could lose the appeal, which would mean that her conviction for murder would remain. The second is that she wins the appeal, but the court then order a retrial. The third outcome is the court quash her conviction. They substitute a conviction of manslaughter, which means that she could be released.
Hi, Mum,
how are you? Hi, Dash. You okay, love?
Yeah, I'm freaking stressed out.
That's the way it's got it. This is all true.
This way, we'll stop it. Don't.
I know. I'm trying to stay strong. I know.
I'm thinking
about the kids. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. And if this doesn't go ahead...
But it is going to go ahead, Tish, it is. We're going to get it home. I can feel it, we are. There's no way we can't. Just had Ishmael crying on the phone.
What?
Just had Ish crying on the phone. Hopefully, this is the last fight and we'll get it out. If it doesn't, God forbid, go the way we want it. I'll never go fighting for her. I never will. Okay, ready? Let's do this. Oh.
Okay.
Oh, thank you.
All right.
This is the appeal of the appellant. Against her conviction of murder, she was sentenced to life imprisonment with a minimum term of 13 years. We have to make our minds up as to whether or not this conviction is unsafe.
My lady, the conviction is unsafe because the evidence that was put before the jury
didn't allow the jury to know about a history of domestic abuse. Some of the experts term that as coercive control.
And doctors agree with the diagnosis of post-traumatic stress disorder. And
the effect of that on the appellant at the time of the killing.
Mr. Unsworth.
It is speculative to determine whether or not another jury presented with all of this evidence that we now have would reject it or accept it. Should the court come to the view that this conviction is unsafe, then we would respectfully submit that the appropriate course of action would be a retrial.
Thank you very much indeed, both of you. We will rise now and come back into court at 2 o'clock.
Yes, my lady.
And be able to inform you as to where we go.
You know, we've done all the crying now. Now it's time to be strong and fight against the system that has wrongfully convicted her. But also have in mind that it could not go the way we want it to go.
Fresh psychiatric evidence would have been admissible at trial and supports the proposition that at the time of the killing, the appellant was suffering from PTSD, which impaired the appellant's ability to exercise self-control and was a significant contributory factor to the killing. Further, the role of coercive control was not explored fully at trial. For these reasons, we allow the appeal and quash the appellant's conviction for murder. There are compelling grounds for the fresh evidence to be heard and evaluated by a fresh jury. A jury could accept all, none, or some of that evidence. We consider that the interests of justice require a retrial.
Retrial.
It's going to be long, but
for
step in the right direction.
The murder charge has been quashed. So she's not a murderer anymore. She's not labelled that. And that means most to her. Don't get me wrong, it would have been nice if they just let her go. But I'm still happy with the outcome. There's still hope. There's still hope, and I've still got lots of hope.
The prospect of a retrial, what does that feel like for you and your family?
It's hard, no matter what, because it's not a nice trial to sit through. The evidence was horrible. So to sit through that again, and then through more evidence, it's going to be brutal for anyone. It's all down to the jury, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
Jury are just normal people, like ourselves, and if they feel the emotion that they felt on the first trial and grief. If they don't, then they don't, and there's nothing that we can't
change it at all.
Yeah, you can't change anything.
We just hope that they see it for what it is and for how heartbreaking and how a family has been ruined in a matter of hours. We've just got to hope for the best, and what will be, will be.
Yeah.
Thank you.
from Liverpool, who was jailed for life for murdering her partner, has had her conviction reduced to manslaughter.
This is the victim's personal statement that the family has written. It's good for her to know what she's done to the family. In the early morning of the 21st of November 2014, our lives took a turn for the worse when our precious son, cousin and nephew's life was taken by the hands of his partner. Questions kept and continued to run through our minds. Why him? Kyle was a well-loved man. He was innocent. He was his mum's only child and her baby who she would walk the ends of the earth for. I wish you all got to meet Kyle to know how much he was the most cared and loving person on this earth, who loved nothing more than being a father to his two beautiful children. We have not been able to rest or grieve due to the constant application being made by the defendant. A decision was made with the support of all family to accept a plea of manslaughter. We are now able to grieve and Kyle is able to rest peacefully.
Sorry.
Doesn't matter which side it's on, it's a tragedy for either family. For Kyle's family, I'm sad that you've lost your own family member. Like, truly, I was devastated for them. And then with Fraser's family, you know, mum's been torn away from her kids. Will be traumatised forever for what she's done. Even when she thinks if she's buried it, it'll come up in her dreams. She'll live this all the time.
I don't think Kyle deserved to die. But I also don't believe my friend should have gone through what she went through. A lot of women going through an abusive relationship, they really believe that the partner could change because that's what they want so much. They love that person, they love the person they met in the beginning when that person was so nice, and that's all they want. They want that person back. I think she loved Kyle. I really do believe she loved Kyle. I believe now she still loves Kyle.